of idiots and sages. How much is your child worth? How much is your grandchild worth? These are not trick questions. They arise from the news that North Carolina recently announced cash compensation to thousands of survivors of their state sterilization program that ran from 1929 to 1974, an astonishing 45 years. North Carolina was but one of many southern states that sterilized people whom it considered as defective. In this, they were supported by authorities as august as the U.S. Supreme Court, which in its now infamous Buck v. Bell case found a state had a right to sterilize its citizens, and a citizen had no constitutional right to oppose it. For in the words of Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, three generations of imbeciles are enough. A North Carolina task force recommended payment of $50,000 each to each survivor. This horrific state practice and the Supreme Court's chilling reasoning in support thereof gives us some insight into how social prejudices and attitudes percolate into all sections of society, and despite their self-evident madness, take on an air of the repellent in the passage of time. If a state could sterilize its own so-called citizens, deny people the right to have children, what is such a state but a dictatorship of arrogance and power? From Prison Nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal. These commentaries are recorded by Noel Hanrahan of Prison Radio.
To his right,
he and the atheists, man. Third time on the arena. Pleasure to be here.
To his right. Yeah, I be the servant of Yah, a soldier, and your servant, in the arena, uncensored. Come on, Black, come back. Black, come back.
It's always the Negroes. And we want to talk about revolution and going to war and changing the policies.
Yeah, I mean.
We got to get together here.
Yes, sir.
Got to get together.
That's right.
All right. Dougie,
what's
going on here in Baltimore? What's going on?
Well,
they're saying, what's going on?
All these different
stories about how Mr. Gray.
I think that more than just this murder of Mr. Gray, it's that more and more people in the communities around the country are connecting the dots and realizing that this is an endemic issue.
Yes.
It's systematic.
Come on.
There's been a 5% increase of us being murdered by the police, Black and brown people, by the police, just since February. And then there's been a 71% increase since March of these murders. And the federal government doesn't require police departments. Of the 17,000 police departments around the country, last year only 700 reported their homicides.
Wow.
So it's been up to grassroots organizations like the Free Thought Project, Malcolm X Grassroots Movement, and you could go to killedbypolice.net. They've been tracking the murders. So I think one of the big issue here is that our federal government has been negligent in protecting these police departments and not holding police accountable. And that's why people are pouring into the streets more and more day by day. More people are connecting the dots and realizing that, you know, this can't continue on.
That's right.
And these police have to start being held accountable. And people are pushing through the repression and the fear of police. You know, we have the data. It's not a question in our mind anymore of whether or not we're being racially profiled or targeted by the police.
Come on.
I mean, we know that it's, I mean, we have, you could go to the war on marijuana in Black and White that was put out by the ACLU several years ago and just see across the whole country how our communities are targeted every day by the police. Mm-hmm. And they're actually being bankrolled by the federal government. They receive grant money.
Come on.
They receive grant money to based solely on the number of arrests and quotas.
Mm-hmm.
And besides just Freddie Gray's murder, you know, we had the Mike Brown murder.
Come on.
We've had Eric Garner, Ezell Ford. The list goes on and on of all these.
So the systems develop a rap sheet per se.
They're developing a rap sheet day by day, and thank God so many people are pulling out their cameras and recording this stuff, because if this stuff wasn't documented, you see how the families are treated. You know, the families get run into roadblocks. They get the doors shut in their faces, and the DAs protect the police at all costs. The Fraternal Order of Police.
Come on,
the police unions have so much power and strength. That,
but Doug, you know they want to start persecuting people who are videotaping now.
They passed the Illinois about that.
Exactly.
They did search your phone, right?
Yes. They were trying to make it a felony, and
that you,
they were
right. If you're trying to take pictures of them committing their crimes, then they can actually make it a criminal act against you for doing it.
And some departments who have implemented the cameras. They have switches on there where they just turn it on.
Exactly. It doesn't help.
So they're not requiring the police who do even put the cameras on, they're not even requiring them to keep them on.
And I heard the police in retaliation are putting some people's arrests on YouTube. To embarrass you, to get you scared to tape.
Well, Eric Garner, they had cameras when they choked homeboy out.
That was Pedestrian that did that.
Yeah,
I'm talking about the New York case where they choked
that.
Had
a dash cam camera.
No, they had the police.
That was
a civilian camera.
Get your back straight.
Okay, well, they had an immigration case just recently in Detroit, which is not even. It wasn't even a week ago. Another guy was killed. The immigration went into the wrong place, killed him, and the people who recorded it.
Yeah.
We're scared to release the video. They have the video, they're scared to release the video because they know the repression. They've already received threats from the police not to release.
Can we develop we got to have this evidence, you know. We got to have, you know, the videotaping. Because like the guy in South Carolina, shot got four hot ones in the back.
Right.
If it was no videotape,
he would have got away.
He was already planning the taser.
No doubt.
Yeah, I mean, he was already in motion to cover that up.
Oh, yeah. I hesitate to call him a brother, came right up and corroborated his lie in reference to what happened in this. And we see this happening over and over again.
Right. The guy came afterward. You can't.
He came after. He wrote, they have to write a statement on these cases.
Right, but the brother didn't see what happened beforehand. So I wouldn't put the blame on the brother.
He is definitely culpable in that situation. Well, because he came back, because he said he rendered aid. And what the guy who was actually filming him showed, he never rendered any aid.
But God made dead, so you can't blame for the death. I don't think you
can blame. No, not for the death. Oh, okay. Just for the cover-up is all I'm saying.
But all these cases are bringing to the light how corrupt this whole system is. The whole system is completely guilty, and it's obvious that we can't count on the Department of Justice. You know, Loretta Lynch, who was just put in there after
Eric Holder.
Right. She's talking about going around to all the police departments.
Giving them a pep talk.
Yeah, giving them a pep talk and support. Because she's feeling like the police are getting a bad rap. Nah. So she's about to go coddle all these police. So she's not looking out for the best interests of us. Neither is President Obama.
He was the one who told her to do it.
Yeah. President Obama, had the audacity to call these young warriors
thugs.
Try to dehumanize poverty, just like they dehumanize everyone they slaughter. You know,
exactly.
You can go to the Middle East.
The biggest thug is them.
You know, they call them Haji F. You know, and they call the Vietnam people, the Vietnamese people. They murdered 5 million people there in Vietnam, Cambodia.
Come on.
So you know, it just shows you the dehumanization process that goes, and it's coming from the highest levels of government.
Absolutely.
And so we can't count on Obama.
That's
obviously.
Why I think we're in the Drapetomania phase right here. That's what I call it: blaming the victim.
Blame the victim.
Yes.
Blame the victim for their own murder.
Yes.
And every single time you see the same process.
Yes. Right.
Let's go into his criminal record.
Uh-huh. Right.
He's a drug dealer. Oh, okay. He sold drugs, or he did drugs.
Right. That's what they're saying about the latest.
They're saying the toxicology reports, if it comes out, will show that it was a legitimate arrest, when in fact he never did anything. What they accused him of doing was eyeing the police officer.
Right.
Come on,
man. They had no reason to arrest him.
Exactly.
And because, you're like you're saying, eyeing an officer and running is not a crime.
Exactly.
And when they did catch him, they tried to stick him with having
a switchblade. Yeah. But it was legal.
But it was legal.
Right.
Exactly.
So even then prosecutors said that.
Yes.
Yeah. So then they tried to fall back on another excuse. And what was the other one that they used to try to...
Because he was in a drug area.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
In a drug area.
Yeah, saying that... But they say that in any black community. They say that for all black communities. They try to say it's a high crime area.
And you know what they also say is that I feared for my life.
Right, right.
That is the catch-all phrase. And they can say that and get away with mass murder by saying
that's why the guy in South Carolina was going to plant the taser.
Exactly. He went for my gun.
Right.
It goes along with the whole program with the stand your ground laws, which are an extension of the slave patrols.
Come on, man. Teach.
You know, giving folks.
Well, how do we push for the decriminalization of just filming the police? Because there seem like they want to try to push that. And like you said, into felonies and checking your phone. So what can we do as a solution to make sure that... Because it seems like all we got is us, Dougie. You know what I'm saying? And all we got is us because we can't... Like you said, if the cop can pull you over and then turn off the camera, okay, like, we're going to beat him up now. You know what I'm saying? So right. We can't... We did a show not too long ago saying, you know, we need body cams. But now they done got a loophole saying they'd cut it off. So now we back to recording ourselves. So
right.
What can... we do to make sure that is protected.
I had a guy, well, you know Neil Franklin. I had Neil Franklin on I have a radio show on the weekend. And I had him on yesterday. And he was saying why it's so important for us to control our local politics.
That's right.
And not count on the federal government for anything.
Mm-hmm.
Because of their attitudes right now, you know.
That's right.
And in order to get legislation done through the federal government, it takes so long waiting for the whole bureaucracy to go into place that we're going to have to be empowered on a local level to control the politicians. Absolutely. In our community now more than ever. But that puts us in another conundrum, too, because we're facing so much voter suppression right now.
Well, but look now, when we talk about Baltimore and the situation, it was actual direct action that took the place of politics and politicians. The direct action of those young people going out, being violent, burning stuff up, mm-hmm. and letting people know we are sick and tired of being killed, and we need... So it's not about politics. It's not about voting black.
I disagree.
Oh, no.
What is it about?
Because they got a black mayor, black prosecutor that got voted in.
And?
So we'll see how the case goes. I don't think they were going to pull those charges if they were white. I don't even think they would convict them.
Right.
Yeah, I would be.
So they did a better job than Ferguson area with his little black people on top.
I think it's controlling the politics of your local now more than ever before, being conscious of who's running.
Right.
And getting these Sambo politicians out.
Ooh, you hit it dead on the head.
They ain't looking out for the interest of the community whatsoever. They're just concerned with their next political
appointment,
their next job.
Absolutely.
What am I going to do? They're constantly, you know, strategizing how I can manipulate folks here. We need politicians that have a heart and actually care about the people. And I mean, just ordinary people like ourselves need to find people in our communities to stand up and possibly run for office. And
but see, I think you said from the beginning, though, that the rampant, what can we call it, corruption from the system, it is so innate that even local politics and politicians can't look it up here in what is this up 78. They elected a mayor in Snailville, female, and she hired a black accountant. They locked her, the board locked her out of her office and wouldn't let her accountant even come in and to take over. So even local politics is so corrupt and so vile.
Is people. So if your person is doing a bad job, you replace that person. Okay?
It's a process, though, sir.
Okay. And You know, but, your praying is a process, and that seemed to have been working for the last 2,000 some years.
But what do you say is
but you
valid
still do
though.
That, don't you? No, go ahead.
Because we have the American Legislative Exchange Council now, you know, this about it's a conglomeration of about 300, 400 corporations.
Right.
That they're in every state, mm-hmm. and all these laws that end up passing through their model bills that are passed along to state legislatures. That's what it came to the people's attention after the murder of Trayvon Martin.
Come on.
The Stand Your Ground bills were mm-hmm. pushed through by Alec. Mm-hmm. All these bills that are coming through now that attack women's rights,
right.
their reproductive freedoms,
right.
mm-hmm. Lesbian, gay, there's all right. these different laws. Mm-hmm. Most of those are Alec bills that are pushed through. To appease the right wing fundamentalist Christian
ilk,
and mind you,
evangelical Christians. They mm-hmm. can, you know, that's a whole voting block for them.
And mind you, that's a spinoff from the corporations of people too.
Absolutely. So, but let me show you the reason I said it is
because Alec, they have a plan that's in place right now to corrupt not only just the state legislatures,
right.
but local.
That's right. Magistrates.
Your local politicians on your city council.
Municipalities.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Now, let me hit Ian and hit you guys with the corruption of the local local judiciary. Remember the case out here where the young man was supposedly a gun runner and they caught him on film and he was running. They had caught him, had him on the ground, and the rent-a-cop, no, he wasn't even a rent-a-cop, the fake wannabe volunteer cop said while they had him on the ground with the one had his knee on his head, the other one had him on the back, and he said, "Oops, I didn't mean to shoot him. I thought I had my
right.
taser."
Right.
And then, wait a minute, okay. then what did they do? They let homeboy go to the Bahamas for vacation.
Well, let me explain the,
come on,
the
man.
Defense. I'm explaining the defense on that. They said that for a long, long time, they've had their pistols on the right. And so they've been training on pistols on the right. All of a sudden, they put their pistols on the left and the taser on the right. So,
man, come on. Nobody has no business out there.
The banana and the pipe trick. The okie doke.
Come on, man.
That's almost as bad as Freddie Gray broke his own neck, right?
Exactly. Come on, man.
Oh, it makes sense now. Everybody go home.
Let me ask you all a question. You know, when we tend to bring up the issue about police brutality, the main thing people like to bring up, especially our people, is what about the black-on-black crime? What
right.
about the fact that,
right.
you know,
good
black
point.
People killing one another and, yeah. oh, don't nobody snitch?
Right.
And here's my argument to that. My argument is, okay, yeah, you got people that won't snitch on other people when they commit crime. What about the fact that when the police do something, that's they don't tell on each other. They don't
exactly.
even arrest one another.
Exactly.
So, I mean, like, where do you say, well, how do you feel when you hear that? What is your first response to those individuals when they try to throw that out?
Well, there was this guy that came on, yesterday, the day before yesterday, talking about the corruption in the Baltimore Police Department. He had tried to come forward against the brutality.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And he started facing all kind of reprisals. I mean, they were threatening his family. They are leaving dead rats on his.
Exactly.
He was coming out of his house in the morning. Dead
right.
rat will be right in
exactly.
the front of the door. I mean, they were threatening his. They were putting him on assignments where his life was in jeopardy.
Exactly.
They weren't responding. Like if you said he needs backup,
everything.
Yeah. They were leaving him alone.
Seprico, baby. Seprico.
Right. 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 So this is what's happening to not only just officers like that.
Right.
In Baltimore. But that's something that's going
that's
on across the country.
That's right.
Because there's so many cases
yes.
of brutality
yes.
and of targeting people
yes.
and planting dope on people.
Yes.
Doing
whatever
they can do to get a conviction.
Right.
And it's become a whole industry to target the superfluous people. And you brought up the black-on-black crime.
Yeah, where do you stand
well,
on that?
See,
how do you feel when people say that?
Over the past 30 or 40 years, they've deindustrialized America. They've sent mm-hmm. all the factories overseas.
Exactly.
Globalization. Corporations
mm-hmm.
are profiting off of the labor.
Cheap labor.
Of cheap labor
right.
across the world.
Cheap.
Mm-hmm. And it's left whole communities
yeah.
with no work. And that was the beginning of when
yeah.
the CIA going along with the Contras down in Nicaragua,
yes,
El Salvador, Guatemala.
Come on.
They were allowing them to funnel cocaine and
yeah.
start the whole crack epidemic around
Maxine Waters.
So the CIA and this government is complicit in starting the whole prison industrial complex.
Absolutely.
And they consider us a superfluous people. And,
yes.
I'm sure y'all have heard of Noam Chomsky, because I love Noam Chomsky. Mm-hmm. But Noam Chomsky said that what they're doing in the United States now is similar to, a lot of times this country goes to other third world countries.
So called.
If they notice that there's an uprising of the poor who mm-hmm. want to have their own social democracy and right. actually vote and mm-hmm. put someone in office, mm-hmm. then this country will do whatever it takes to
destabilize,
to stop the uprising.
Exactly.
And, right. they'll pay death squads.
Exactly.
To go murder organizers, whoever gets in their way,
yes.
To control the politics, so they can control the money and the
yes.
resources of the money.
That's right.
In the United States, they have to be a little bit more civilized. So what they've done here with all these superfluous people who don't have work that they feel that they don't need anymore for their labor is they just build prisons. And so it's not a mistake that we don't have institutions of education for
Absolutely.
Our children.
Absolutely.
It's not a mistake that we don't have adequate health care.
Absolutely.
It's not a mistake that we don't have jobs.
Come on, come on.
Because Ruthie Gilmore, mm-hmm. Who is she considered herself an abolitionist. Mm-hmm. She works with Susan Burton mm-hmm. and Angela Davis. And she called, I don't have it written down. Mm-hmm. I meant to write it before I came here. But the definition of racism is the definition of racism for her is that when you die a premature death, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. When the institutions that are lined up and the conditions are lined up so that
right.
you die earlier,
uh-huh.
that's a form of racism. It's
yes.
not just somebody saying I don't like black folks or
right.
I don't like Mexicans, or it's the whole system that's put in place.
The new
so that we die.
Oh, okay.
So if a white person dies early, that's racist.
Well, okay. There's some communities in Baltimore where the life expectancy is 20 years. Death earlier than a white right. person.
Wait a minute.
Just because of the conditions they have.
If a
exactly.
white person dies early, is it considered racist?
Well, if you looked at the statistics around the whole country, for example, we die on average 10 years sooner than white people.
Exactly.
Because we don't have access to health care. And
prenatal care, the whole nine.
Right, what do you call it?
So now what about the crime?
Not prenatal care.
Well, that's before the child.
Not pre-existing conditions. That's not the word I'm thinking of. Mm-hmm.
Well,
but
go ahead.
I don't know if I believe those statistics.
Well, let's
I think hospitals kill more than
well, they do.
Oh, you do?
But let's reflect upon what our sister asked the question in reference to them saying that
we kill each other. It's a false equivalence.
Okay.
Police are hired to protect.
Thank you.
Regular citizens are not...
Exactly.
Allowed to protect. They're not hired to protect. We don't support them to protect the community.
That's
a
right.
citizen kill another citizen, he's not getting away with it.
Mm-hmm.
The
exactly.
police kill you, he got the courts, he got all the courts to back him.
Exactly.
It's not the same. We expect the police to come in here and pacify things. You're not expecting a regular citizen to do that.
But you
they're
know
not
what?
Hired to do that. They're not paid to
The reason
do that.
I brought that
they're
up
not
the
trained
term,
to do that.
The reason I brought up that was because we have conditions in our community where there's especially with the underground drug market, because
right.
people have had to use underground drug markets to survive
mm-hmm.
in communities with no jobs.
Exactly.
And it's not I'm talking about low level drug dealing,
right.
not
street level.
The illusion is that there's kingpins in all these
Rick
different
Ross.
Can
right.
I say this before?
But so that's why I want to bring this up is that the intercommunal violence in our communities is created from that.
Exactly.
From not
right.
having
okay.
jobs.
Exactly.
From being oppressed.
Exactly.
Okay,
right.
I want to say something.
And they control that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, white people commit crime the same way. People next to each other is going to commit crime.
Right.
Right. There's mm-hmm.
going
to be peace
it's
always going to
be
war.
There. Nobody says what happened to white on white crime. Mm-hmm. Nobody brings that up.
Right.
The same statistic, the same percentage, almost.
Mm-hmm. Well, they control
but
the media.
90% of white
well, it's more of them than us.
I know what you're saying.
Absolutely.
But sometimes
don't forget
we
what
do
you
disproportionately
say,
have more intercommunal violence in our communities because we're in communities where the conditions are, we're up against each other.
Because white crime is being recorded. Crystal meth is killing them.
Yeah,
never see, you turn on the TV, somebody getting arrested for crystal meth.
Well, they
or
do get arrested.
Or they're doing a raid. They do
yeah.
get arrested,
yeah.
but it's not seen.
It's not
exactly.
Right.
They don't.
And I see where... Ian is going, and it's gonna go into my question for Tiffany, because the media paints this picture, and that's why we got shows like The Arena and Hear Y'all that people are turning to, because they're not buying the so my question is, because when the paddy wagon picked up Mr. Gray, right?
They
put him in there. Mm-hmm. They had made an unreported stop and picked up another
so-called
inmate or prisoner. And the inmate said, oh, well, he heard thrashing around, and then he felt like Mr. Gray was trying to kill himself.
No, so, they misquoted him.
Oh,
he absolutely
he
came back and said when he got in he was put in the vehicle, and they use them in separate areas, because if they have a male and female, they don't put them in the same area.
Right.
He said it was because the way they were driving, it sounded like his body was limp, and he was therefore being cast to and fro in the back of the vehicle, not like he was trying to kill himself.
Right, right.
He came back, and that's to the media.
The media is quite supremacy controlled,
and that's how they spin it. Go ahead, sweetheart.
I mean, I hear what you're saying, but you know, it's been a lot of stories about that. I mean, it's been that, oh, like you said, he was trying to kill himself. They didn't know what happened.
Somebody said he had surgery on his back. I heard that rumor.
I mean, I heard that he had surgery on his back, but I mean, you and I and everybody else know that if your vocal cord, your vocals is messed up, and you die from a spinal injury, and then from looking at the picture, it looks like it was more than just a spinal injury. It looked like he was beat up.
Oh, no doubt.
I think the charges are actually, the charges are undercharged. And notice
for the police.
Yeah. And
notice, what do you mean by undercharge?
Because
not enough charges.
See, I think that they've tried to kind of make the case where he died from inside,
from what happened, being driven around the
injuries were sustained on the sidewalk.
Prior to, absolutely.
Because you've seen when they brought him over to the thing,
and
his neck was messed up. He couldn't even move his legs.
Exactly.
His legs were already in a state of paralysis.
Absolutely.
When they were dragging him to. I think that they undercharged. And so don't be surprised when this whole case goes to trial.
Yes.
When these officers are set up to get off.
Right.
Because notice that.
Exactly.
This happens, they may not.
This happens, all the time.
This happens over and over and over
they
again.
May not.
The prosecutors forget how to charge a case.
Yes.
Look at in Florida.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, we watched it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
While
you're watching it, you're going, wait a minute.
You're talking about Trayvon.
Yeah, Trayvon and Jordan Davis.
Jordan Davis.
They went for first degree,
right? Jordan Davis went to prison.
It was like it happened on the sidewalk. They did everything as if there was just neglect
when
he was transported.
I think that's an easy charge again.
Well, you're not a lawyer, though.
Well,
to prove. I just have a feeling that it's a setup.
Yeah,
it's to appease the people temporarily. And then eventually, you know.
Let me get to the crowd. There's a difference between.
I just
want to
brace people for it.
And being charged.
No. Being arrested and charged and being convicted.
Exactly.
Okay, I was going to say Jordan Davis killer. It's in jail. It's in prison as we speak right now. So.
But
the first trial, though, the first trial,
no, he didn't get locked up. But when they did the trial again, they convicted him.
He got charged for shooting at the car, at the other people in the car when they left. On the first trial, he didn't get charged with killing Jordan Davis.
But he's in prison.
And let's just tell everybody who may not know, Jordan Davis was the guy with the loud music.
Right.
And at the gas station. And they just drove up playing their music, minding their business. And then the killer refrigerator went over there. What y'all doing? Playing live music. And pow, pow,
but
pow.
See, that goes back to what Tiffany said earlier about, see, that guy was just he wasn't a police officer.
He was a so-called citizen.
Vigilante.
Right.
Stand your ground, vigilante.
Exactly.
But see, we can't control, we can control police better than we control citizens. Because citizens could just, you know what I'm saying, the police have guidelines, and then if they kill somebody, well, we're going to suspend you with pay, you know.
Right.
It's not, you know.
Exactly.
Right.
They all get suspended.
Take 2 weeks to come up with your story. Don't worry about it.
And they make money off killing. He walked away with a million.
A million.
What about the riots? Okay, now, Everybody talk about, oh, this is the most destructive thing they ever done. They this is crazy. This is crazy, yes, and stuff like that. But they fail to talk about when the white people, after any games or any events they had, they tear up everything. Right. They throw stuff around.
Yeah. Good old American fashion fun there.
That's right. What that is.
When we do it against injustice, it's a problem.
Right.
It's an issue.
That's a big problem.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's the profile. That's the that's the image that the world, they want the world to see of us. And how, and see, that's why I could never support, vote for, or think that these killers are are going to change because we vote for their system.
Right.
The system is corrupt from the top to the bottom.
Right.
They've already created a profile against us to define us by behavior that they have helped to popularize through beer commercials and everything.
It's a social
but when we do it all of a sudden, it's wanton, rampant criminal behavior.
Right.
That we have to suppress.
It's exaggeration.
Because people, I remember back in the day, the media say something like, oh, well, he was a drug dealer, and we would go for it. We're not going for that now. You know what I'm saying? People are not going for the Spocks.
Yeah, these people are waking up.
Yeah, people are waking up now.
But I agree with what you're saying, though. We can't count on just going to the ballot.
Right.
We're going to have to start connecting the dots with all the different industries and corporations who are invested in our suffering.
Yes.
All those invested in the private prison industry. Those invested.
Well, we are going to need the ballot, though, Dougie, to decriminalize, because we're still going to have to record these police.
Well, let me show you.
We do need to vote for that.
Malcolm X grassroots movement. They got they got different plans that they've been putting in place to defend our communities. I mean, maybe we should get more organized and have more cop watches. Yes. So that we're monitoring.
Let me say
this:
prison industrial complex, Mumia Abu-Jamal.
Yes,
there are so many of our people that they took education out of the prison systems.
Right,
they took the ability to fight your case out of the prison systems. They have taken so much out. And when I look at Mumia, and of course you've had him on the show, not him on the show, but his speeches and recordings. They allowed his health to go down so severely that he was in a diabetic epileptic shock or something that they just...
His skin is bad.
They're trying to kill him. They're trying to kill our people. Medical neglect. So at the end of the day, political action is not going to stop that. Because wardens over those insane asylums... they're sadist.
Go ahead.
It's a part of. It's not. See, your religious mind can't get past. It's not the be all end all. Exactly. It's part of. Okay. In order for us to keep filming the police, we're gonna have to get politically involved. I'm not saying it's the be all end all. Get out of that mind state, Gideon. Good. It's part of the puzzle.
Okay.
It's part of
I'll
the
give
piece.
You that. I'll
see,
give you that.
Your religious mind said, there's one solution, one God's gonna save us. Get out of that, Gideon.
Well,
there's multiple problems, multiple solutions, multiple pieces to it, and voting is part of that.
It is part.
Mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying? In order for us to stop demonizing, vote the goddamn keep videotaping the killer.
And they're passing laws to say you can't do it.
So we
the question is,
thank you.
In the political strata is saying, I'm going to go for this. I don't want the citizenry to
Disobedience or civil disobedience.
But civil disobedience is good, but in order to threaten a person's job, if you're a politician, I'm going to say, you know what, we're going to vote, get you out of office. You're going to be like, oh, Mr. Plexin, what do you want? What do you want to do? So, because the Hispanics goddamn get things moving, the LGBT got things moving.
They work together, though.
Exactly.
They work together. They don't just vote. They work together. They work in the community.
I think we should do everything on the table, just like I always say. I mean, by all means necessary, everything from the voting to just base grassroots organizing, building up a network, so that we can. Not be dependent on corporations. Mm-hmm. Start using more
the churches down, right?
Start doing more.
$420 billion.
They're taking up a lot of square footage. We can use that footage.
But we do need more cooperative economics. I think there's a great website called communitywealth.org where people are starting to do more.
Do you think that the protests are a form of unity?
Yeah, and we need to stay in the streets. keep on hitting the streets, yeah. keep on going out there, because this is beyond Freddie Gray.
Yes.
This is beyond all these different murders. It's,
yeah.
it's systemic. It's about the whole system.
Exactly.
The massive inequality that
yes.
exists in our country.
Wealth inequality.
Where the 0.1% is controlling all the money
this
and the wealth.
Because the media is trying to use a black woman to discredit this as a black woman, Tiffany.
Yes, let me hear you on this.
Let me hear you about how you feel about the rioters, the looters.
You know what? I'm glad you asked that question. Woo!
You don't know where I'm going with it, right?
Okay, let me ask you this. You know what? I feel like it is what it is because they...
Are you for it?
Am I for it? Am I for the writing?
Hell yeah.
Is it justifiable? I'll make it easy for you. Is it justifiable?
Yes, in my opinion, it's justifiable.
Okay, so if you had a son, you wouldn't go out there and pull him and slap him, on, you know, slap him around, tell him not to do that?
I mean, I wouldn't just slap him around. I mean, because, I mean, if he's fighting for a cause, that's one thing.
So you want to stop him?
You go out there and throw rocks with him?
I mean, I'll be out there. I mean, why not? Why not be out there fighting with him? Why not?
You wouldn't stop.
Fight down. No, I mean, if he's doing something that's, you know, justifiable and it's for, you know, fighting the cause or something, why would I want to just stop what he's doing?
And you heard it from the arena.
Yeah, I felt like yes.
Why would I want to stop?
I felt so liberated. I seen MRAP racing down the street, probably going about 50, 60, and I saw all these bottles and like rocks flying, hitting it on the side. Mm-hmm. And man, I felt so good seeing it. It just felt good.
It felt good seeing
the young people get some frustration.
Right.
Out, you
yeah.
know?
Right,
right. I mean, we're tired of being occupied by That's these right. people.
Exactly.
No, because the
constantly
media...
racially profiled, criminalized.
Yes. Right.
You know,
exactly.
From Dougie. Ever since, from the cradle to the grave.
From the cradle to the grave.
I'm tired of looking in the rearview mirror, though. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Our whole lives, we go from point A to point B mm-hmm. at night, and we constantly have to be looking in the rearview.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? It got to stop.
I know.
That's why I'm an advocate of ending the drug war. We got to stop the drug war.
Yeah.
Legalize. Right. Control all the underground, get rid of these underground drug markets so there's no intercommunal violence.
Oh, okay.
And it gets rid of the system that is the engine that creates this whole prison industrial complex, mass incarceration, 2.5 million people incarcerated. 100 million people now got criminal records. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, well, as far as my concern, I feel like, you know, they just had the reason that they not going to go for the pacifism. I mean, no disrespect to the peaceful protesters. Mm-hmm. They not getting ready to just throw their hands up or turn the other cheeks or anything like that. Mm-hmm. They're saying that, look, right. we finna let it be. And as far as my concern, this is my opinion. Mm-hmm. The true God and goddesses are those who can stand up against the oppression, who's not mm-hmm. afraid to mm-hmm. speak mm-hmm. out, who's not afraid to go out there and let their voices be heard, mm-hmm. and not just with words, but also with action.
Okay. Well, the reason I asked you that, Tiffany, is because the media is trying to pit the black man and woman against each other.
You know,
we naturally see the black, you know, I see it on Facebook when the mother took her son and started slapping him around.
Right, and you know, she got recognition.
Right.
So you see this trying to cause a Willie Lynch effect there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, you got to think about it. I feel like I understand where she's coming from as a mother. She doesn't want her son to be killed by the police or anything like that. I can understand it, but at the same time, I mean, he feels like that's his manhood. And as far as his reason is concerned, he said the reason why he did it because he had friends that was
been killed by the police.
I don't know if she's a single mother or what.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, she's a single mother. So
her father would be out there.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, so she's a single mother. So, okay, for
Six
him.
Kids.
Right.
Okay, for him as a young man, I mean, he feels like, that's his, mm-hmm. you know, that's part of his manhood, kind of, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Because he's showing that revolutionary side, you know, and as a mother, I mean, you ain't got to go out there and throw stones with him, but you kind of say, you know, son, you know what? I understand how you feel. I don't blame you. You know, do what you need to do. I don't let your frustration out or something. Okay. You know, I mean, she, you know, she could have done that, or you know, she didn't like it, she could have trained him how she want him to go about doing things. You know what I'm saying? Instead of just going out there slapping him in front of everybody like that, you know. So I mean,
the thing is, they used her on all the networks,
right?
Absolutely,
to basically reinforce the narrative that violence is needed to keep these young people in check. Almost, you know, to contribute to the narrative of, see, that's why the police should be able to murder, brutalize.
Exactly.
This is what is needed to keep them in order.
But see, on the flip side of that, if she had been doing that under any other circumstance,
she would be in jail. Child abuse.
Absolutely. Right. Absolutely. And see, at the end of the day, this is how they flip the story to fit their narrative. particular agenda.
If he came home in a skirt and she went upside his head like that,
she would have been in jail.
Right. I mean,
she would have been in jail.
It's not so much me about.
But now she's the heroine. Because the story is white. Let him be himself.
Right, you know what? And I mean, it's not that so much I have mixed emotions. It's just that, you know, I can understand how she feels as a mother, but at the same time, I just have my own opinion. I feel she's contradicting herself.
She said,
don't
use violence.
Exactly. Right.
She contradicted herself right then and there. Yeah, and she know. I mean, instead of her understanding, knowing the situation that's going on, knowing the fact that there's issue, a young man that got killed, and this is why they retaliated, and instead of saying, you know, I understand how my son feel, and I understand his anger behind this, I mean, she just had to embarrass him pretty much and just kind of
She was totally disconnected from the real purpose of why the people. Now, Freddie Gray being in the back of that police van, they claimed that he damaged, there was a wound in the back of his head that was synonymous, or it was, the impression was like a bolt in the back of the car. Now, they do have what's called a rough ride with the police.
It's like you could probably see it just a little.
Exactly.
But you know what? Get in and see, this is the difference between you and I.
Yes, sir.
See, you get your information from the mainstream media. See, I watched the Real News Network where the guy went around, where the guy said he was
from Baltimore.
Baltimore, where they said the guy was already paralyzed.
Well, we saw it.
So, but I'm saying, when you put the information out there, like he was trying to bump himself around, when he was getting in the van, he couldn't move.
Exactly.
But see, it depends on who you get your news source from.
That was the Washington Post. The Washington Post released that report, and it was just another part of the mainstream, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
To destroy the whole case.
Exactly.
So that the public says, oh, okay, no wonder. The police didn't do nothing wrong, see?
Right.
And they did this after the Mike Brown.
Absolutely.
You know.
Defaming, slander.
Yeah, they came back with the grand jury. And the prosecutor picks the, you know, he takes out all the testimony of people who've seen him with their hands up.
Right.
And then said that all of them were liars.
Yes.
None of their credibility can be trusted.
Exactly.
They're all liars. That's right. But then at the end, the mainstream media, how they tried to spin it was, see, all these protesters who came out around the country.
You mean the thugs?
Yeah, the thugs and starting all this. It's them
that are
the problem, and they're out fighting for nothing.
Well,
they're fighting just because of Mike Brown, but not the whole system.
Exactly.
Everybody's in the streets about the whole system.
Right.
The whole system of mass incarceration, massive inequality, no health care, no jobs, no education.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? They're defunding our schools.
You think this is just the police or the white man in general psychopathic behavior? What would you think?
Ooh, good question.
Wow. If it's just the police or...
It's the white man's psychopathic behavior. Absolutely.
I think it's a lot of that.
Absolutely. Hannity came on and
they keep defending it.
So the issue with Hannity, this racist, bigoted talk show commentator, that's all he is, a commentator, is he's tried to say that it was a legitimate arrest because of toxicology reports that they gonna trump up to say that there was some type of drug in his system. Well, first of all, what he didn't look at, it was not a legal arrest from the beginning. That's the whole, see that part they refused to look at.
But
he never should have been arrested for looking at the police officer.
But they've used that throughout history, throughout America's history, you know?
Exactly.
Don't look at the white man.
Right.
Don't look at the white woman.
Come on,
if you look at the cop, some cops, they actually
feel threatened.
They try to take it as
an aggression.
You're trying to intimidate me
exactly
by looking back at me.
Exactly.
So I mean, I know that just about everybody here can say that they've drove by police and have tried to not look at them.
Right.
Because you know,
I know I try
if you make if you make contact,
hey, come on,
it could attract attention.
Absolutely,
and that is really and that though. And that is and really that scared? Is the that's the intensity of white supremacy and the legacy.
Absolutely,
of really how, scared though.
But see,
really
that's scared? What they use. They try to say fear for my life.
No. They try to make it look like you're challenging their authority.
Exactly.
White man jumps off bungee jumps off buildings, clowns Mount Everest, swims the Atlantic.
Come on.
He's scared of a teenager with no gun.
But look at the perception of the majority of white folks out there who don't have any connection to the communities whatsoever.
Right.
Check out their perception of these officers.
Right.
And
they really believe that the officers are their friends.
And Dougie, hold on.
You know what I'm saying?
Of course. I mean, you think about it. Think about it. Wait a minute. Hold on. Okay, wait a minute. Think about it. They get more protection from the officers than we do.
Right.
Do you understand that?
Right, right.
They get more protection, okay? Well, now, I mean, then
the they you're referring to is who?
When I'm talking about the white folk. The white folk get more protection from the officers than we do, okay? And they ain't got to worry about the police riding up and down the street on their neighborhood like we do.
Exactly.
Okay, the police come riding up down our street all the time. They looking for something. Yeah, profiling. They making sure. They want to see if we doing something we ain't got no business doing.
That's right.
When we marched on the 22nd and protesters went on the freeway, when I got home, I went on YouTube to see if anybody had released any YouTube from the event, and the first video I seen was from this white lady that was driving on the freeway when the freeway got blocked.
Right,
and I saw you were walking alongside the freeway.
Oh, really?
They're playing the drums and everything, you know. And an officer came up along the side, and she said she was like, be careful, telling the officer, be careful, officer.
Yes.
She said, is it okay if I go right? Is it okay if I go now? And he's like, go ahead that way. And she's like, be careful.
And see, what
you know what I'm saying? These people,
worried
about the police. The protesters just walking down the street. I mean, walking protesters.
Right.
And she really felt like the protesters
were the enemy.
The enemy that are possibly threatening the police right now.
Well, see, that's the story that they projected upon the populace, because at the end of the day, when they sent the National Guard into Baltimore, it was to protect property. It was to protect the wealthy. Well, they're supposed to. Wait a minute now. You done changed. Which side of your neck? I thought you said they're supposed to serve us. Mm-hmm. And you're right. That's their initiative.
You would think they're supposed to serve us, but I got to tell you something.
But at the end of the day, though, what we're talking about is European white supremacy has put the police force in position to protect white women. That's why white women want them to build the prison industrial complex. Who run the white corporations primarily?
That's what you say.
Okay, I was going to say something to you about what you said as far as police supposed to protect. Did you know technically they don't have to protect? They can choose and pick who they want to protect?
Of course.
You can sit there, call the cop right now. 911 operator. The dispatcher picks up the phone, whatever. You tell them what your situation is. And they send it off to the police. The police can decide whether they want to come to your aid or not.
Right.
That's right. And there has been cases. I know I was looking at the one about with San Jose and versus Hartzler or something like that, where a lady had called the police because her husband was abusive to her. It was back in the 70s. And by the time when she told the dispatcher what was going on, the dispatcher had contacted the police and told them what happened. And the police had other situations taking place. I guess he had to go to other priorities or whatever. So but he came about 30 minutes later after she had called the cops. By the time he got there, she was already dead.
I'll give you a better case than that. One of Jeffrey Dahmer's victims
ran
out the house.
Ran out
the
bleeding out of his anus and everything.
Jeffrey Dahmer talked him right out of it.
And they took the child right back to Jeffrey Dahmer.
Yeah.
And what about the geneticist? That's true.
Yeah.
That is absolutely true. It's funny, but it's true.
Right
there. They took the child right back, a little young brother, back to the cannibalistic killer. Now, what about the geneticist who was in his own yard, and the police came and arrested him? Remember, Obama went to him, and they wanted to go have beer together. Do you remember that?
Right.
That man ain't no geneticist, man. Historian, man. Don't give him that title.
No, but
well, he's coming on TV like he's a genetic. He's not no geneticist.
Well, that's what he claims to be.
No, the there was a sign that a protester was
Gates.
Holding up.
Gates, exactly.
It's not to protect and serve; it's to search and destroy.
That's it.
You know, or exactly. when did serve and protect become search and destroy?
Since 2007,
and that's what's going on. We got the militarization of the police.
Absolutely,
sorry, that's
political now. That's political. Wait a minute. Political.
Right, it's political. So you have to change the political system, Gideon.
They look for any excuse to use
their new toys.
If you give them all these toys,
yes,
they're going to try to find any excuse they can to use it.
Absolutely.
And strap on that helmet. You've seen Barney Fife looking cool on top of the MRAP with the 60 cal, you know.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Just for some peaceful protesters.
Come on now.
We're talking about unarmed people, young people who are just trying to voice, you know, their outrage.
We're running out of bad guys.
It's
unbelievable, right?
You have to look at now.
What's going on here
in Atlanta.
And that's why we got to stay in the streets.
People were talking about the number of caskets that were seen by many citizens that have been stacked up, body bags. They are preparing for what they are getting ready to set off. Rex 84 is a governmental plan that you can Google that talks about insurgents in the community. That's what. No, that's not. That's real. That's real.
The only reason I don't like to give in to
Google Rex 84,
because I was talking to a guy at a gas station. He was a truck driver, and he was a white guy. And we're talking about the thing going on in Baltimore, and he brings up that they have a plan in about 3 months or 4 months they're going to take over militarize the whole
martial law.
You're going to have martial
law. Yeah, I heard that too.
But and it gives into the right wing conspiracy narrative, scare tactic, so they can keep buying guns.
Yes,
it serves the Walmarts of the world and the stand your ground laws, you know, so that the white folks can get more guns.
Wait a minute now, Obama was elected politically, when Obama was elected, duly elected, white folks bought more guns and ammunition than ever before. They were running out of guns. What do you mean, for what? What are you on, man?
You're on the turn the other cheek, non-violence. First of all, let me tell you something about owning guns, Gideon.
Yes.
If it wasn't for the guns, there would be no Deacons of Defense, no Black Panthers. A lot of black people would have got killed in Tulsa, God dang Auburn. So
a lot of black people did get killed in Tulsa.
But a lot of black people fought.
What happened to the Black Panthers? They end up like Swiss cheese. Come on, man.
But black people, but hold on.
Hey, if you think about something, go ahead.
I'm saying that I'm for arming. For arming it. Yeah. So just go ahead, Dougie. I'm against how people want to be, just take their Bible and say, oh, the Lord's going to save us.
Right.
You know, the Most High will save us.
What I wanted to say was that, you had asked her about, you know, how she would have responded to the young man that, you know, all that. And they say that, you know, in Baltimore, that day before school was over, they cut off all the transportation systems.
Right.
So those young people had to walk, some of them had to walk miles to get home, and they were being harassed by the police. Mm-hmm. So in a way, if you think about it, they may have been, you know, completely instigated for that whole situation to happen with those young people. And then it builds into the narrative on the corporate media. See, look at them.
Look at
them.
Wilding.
So it gives more of an excuse. We need more militarized.
Exactly.
You know,
that's right.
And then it sets fear off to all the white folks.
Exactly.
See, that's why we need the police.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So, I mean, the whole thing, the way the corporate media and these police know how to manipulate situations.
Of course.
So a lot of people, we have to be conscious of that.
That's yes.
Right. Otherwise, we can give in to the same conspiracy thinking.
Exactly.
That it's all
about. There is a conspiracy.
It goes into the
it's
money.
Governmental
it's all about
now.
Money.
Mm-hmm. It is
saying?
About
we
money.
We can manipulate these white people to be scared and buy more guns.
Yes.
And then go vote more right wing.
That's
to have
more,
to
yes,
have more
yes,
law
yes.
and order. So then in 2016, you know,
we're gonna have killer cops even more.
Even
so.
Though we're having this conversation about social justice,
a tyrannical
and
government, basically a tyrannical government.
It could reinforce it and be worse. More right wing people saying, no, we need law and order. We need more militarized police.
They want a tyrannical government.
They already got that. Now, what I'm going to ask you guys this, because see, this is the other part of what they say about us. Oh, they're burning up their own neighborhood. They're killing their own. See, there is a strategy when we say we need to have the men out front and the women at home. Now, what they've said is there were over 200 businesses that were burned. But what the media puts out is that they're burning their own neighborhoods. Look, they don't have enough sense but to go and destroy their own area.
Well, okay, what is it that we really own in our neighborhood? We don't own
zero.
Zero, yeah, exactly. Especially the corner stores, all these liquor stores, that's mostly owned by the Arabs or the Asian or white corporations. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. So, we don't own anything.
And we maybe got one or two. We maybe got one or two.
Well, see, they burned down the CVS. How are the old people going to get their drugs?
I know. They burned the CVS.
Only one in the whole area?
Okay, wait a minute.
What they burn in Ferguson? Quick Trip.
A Quick Trip.
Let's talk about, but they don't talk about how they go overseas and send out drones to other countries.
We did last week, absolutely.
I know you guys run to my ear.
Yes, the mess.
What about Congo, the 5 million people that died because of they trying to get the cocaine minerals
out
the ground?
The Hutus and the Tutsis.
Yes, yeah, Sierra Leone.
Rwanda.
Oh, wait a minute. Nigeria oil spill?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, Timmy.
Oh, yeah. What about the oil spill in the Gulf? They got enough money to blow up, murder all these people.
Right. What I'm saying, unlike Gideon, I don't care about the CNNs and Foxes. I care less. This is what I care about right here. You know what I'm saying?
So, I'm with you on that.
The people are here, right here.
Right.
I'm good.
Right.
I'm just talking about in general. Yes. I know you.
Let's get them here on the arena.
That's right.
I got a few websites. We only got 5 minutes.
Yes.
You think I can name off some of these?
Yeah, name off.
Okay. If y'all want to learn more about stopping police murder or tracking these murders, you could go to, this is a great website, killedbypolice.net.
Exactly.
Killedbypolice.net. Since January, there's been over 392 murders by police, and we're on track to be one of the worst years ever.
Yes.
And that's why the summer is so important for us to have things for our young people to do, because these police obviously are out of control,
and they
could be murdering our young people. So organize. Mm-hmm. Another spot you can check is mappingpoliceviolence.org. Mm-hmm. Mappingpoliceviolence.org. That's a good website. Mm-hmm. You could also go to thefreethoughtproject.com. Mm-hmm. Thefreethoughtproject.com. Mm-hmm. And stolenlives.org is a good one. Mm-hmm. That's been around for a long time. That was started from a lot of the families in New York after Malcolm Ferguson.
Going back.
Then there's stopmassincarceration.net. You know, I'm an affiliate of Stop Mass Incarceration Network with Carl Dixon, Dr. Cornel West, and so is Tiffany.
Right.
You can check out Operation Ghetto Storm. That was the report that came out from Malcolm X Grassroots Movement in 2012.
Mm-hmm.
And you can check that out on their website. They track 313 murders of black folks by police, security guards, and vigilantes in 2011.
Come on.
Then there's fatalencounters.org, fatalencounters.org. Mm-hmm. ProPublica wrote a report about a year ago, but their statistics were on the FBI reports, which, you know, since the police don't report as much to the FBI, but it's a black male between the age of 19 and 25 is like 21 times as likely to be murdered by police than a white person.
1.5 million brethren missing.
Okay, got 3 seconds. So, all right, everybody.
Three minutes.
Keep fighting the power. Keep standing in the streets. Organize.
We got 3 minutes.
Next week, we're going to have Ahmed come on and talk about, we're going to continue the conversation with Yemen. Mm-hmm. Not Yaman. Saudi Arabia. You know, bombing Yemen. We're going to have actual Yemenis on here by the name of Ahmed. So
come
Ahmed,
on.
We're going to help seed in it.
Everybody give it up close to the people in Baltimore.
Yes.
Fight back.
Yeah,
fight the back. to the young people that make make those M-Raps race
fight
down the streets.
All right, fight please.
Trying to help the